What's up, guys? How are you?
Hey, AD.
Good. First interview of the day. Congratulations.
All right.
I might have heard a couple of the previous ones.
Uh-oh.
don't worry.
Okay, well, I hope you got some questions.
Yeah, you got some new questions for us?
Actually, well, have we officially started? Is this the interview? Yeah. I guess we should just do it. All right. Robin, Rick, Tom, and Dax, Cheap Trick, welcome to the show. Thank you for being here.
All right, man.
Before anything else, I've spent like the last 2 days listening to your new record constantly, and we don't have time to play the whole thing, but let's just hear a little bit of this. Can you guys hear this on your end?
Oh, yeah.
No.
Hey, AD, are you doing two stations, one Orlando, one Houston? Is that right?
One Orlando, one Houston. They spread me thin.
Oh, yeah. Well, you must be rich by now.
Ha! You'd think that. My goal for this year is to combine my 8 mediocre jobs into 2 really good ones.
Good thinking.
It hasn't happened yet. Let's listen to the music, though. Shh. Stop talking over your own music. Now, there's a reason why I'm playing you this. Let's wait for the vocal to come in. Yeah, here we go. So, first and foremost, awesome, awesome record. But I'm listening to this record over and over again, and you guys could be on tour with the Killers or Imagine Dragons or the Bravery, and it would be a perfect fit. Like, I'm listening to this record, and whatever it is that Cheap Trick has, there's always been a distinctly youthful quality to it, and that hasn't gone away. But I gotta feel like the reason you would work... Oh, well, hold on. So good. Humongous. Windows down, volume up, driving fast. It's awesome. But I have to feel like the reason you would fit in so well with all these bands is that because they've all been studying the Cheap Trick songwriting handbook a little closely for the past 10, 15, 20 years. Do you ever hear bands playing and go like, you're welcome, we started that? Glad you picked it up.
But we don't hear too many thank yous.
Well, you should.
We're getting a big thank you coming up here. We're going to be inducted to the Hall of Fame, which is a pretty big thank you, I think.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. No, I mean, look, new album, Rock and Roll Hall of Fame induction. And it just when you listen to this record, you're just like, the breadth and depth of their work is just really something else. What is it like now on the verge of your induction into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame? Looking at each other going, all right, let's write a record or let's play a show. How is it different now to when you guys started out? Or is it the same?
I think it's pretty much the same. I mean, it's a Cheap Trick record. It's, you know, a little bit different chord-wise. The songs are different, but it's still Cheap Trick.
Yeah, you know, we've got diverse. I think that we've had that since our first record. And it's like, this one's no different. I mean, it's like... You know, we wouldn't want to have all of one sort of thing or one, but you know, it's like when we don't really put together the album in advance. We just do song by song, and it's like some fit right, and some fit, and some need to be onto a different record, so it's kind of hard to decide. You know, choosing songs that you're going to put on it, because we recorded 8 songs in L.A., then we went on tour, then we recorded 7 songs in L.A., went back on tour, then we recorded 8 songs in Nashville, went back on tour and recorded another 8. So all of a sudden we had 30 songs, and so like wow, you know, like we had to. Narrow it down and finish them all. It's like,
and you know, we're a pretty diverse group. We write all kinds of material and stuff, but we're not AC/DC where everything's kind of linear. You know, we kind of jump around.
Yeah, no, you.
I like their linear. I like their linear, but that's not us. You know,
there's some bands that have made an awesome career out of writing the same song over and over again, and they're some of my favorite bands in the world. You guys are playing with all the colors in the palette, though. You definitely don't limit yourself in the same way a lot of other bands do. But, I mean, I'm talking more about the feeling that you get, like, looking at each other. Maybe you're getting ready to write a song. Look, Cheap Trick has been a band that lived, thrived, and survived in the live arena. That moment where you're looking at each other about to go on stage now, what's it like compared to back in the day?
No, we don't look at each other.
We look at each other?
Hell, I can't even look at my face.
Can't see back there.
I take all the mirrors off the walls in my house.
I've done that too. It's like, you know, it's like, you know, it's like, I don't really think about it myself. It's like, I say every night, I say, oh, and here's my favorite lead singer in the whole wide world. I point to Robin. It's like, and it's like, yeah, I mean it, but, you know, but we don't go over and hug each other or do all kinds of that kind of stuff. I think it's a mutual respect, you know, that we probably we don't hang around each other 24/7, but at the same time, it's like I'm working with some of the best guys in the world. I mean, Tom is, you know, he's not Jaco Pastorius or what, you know, it's like, whatever.
Jaco.
Isn't that the guy that,
whoever that is,
the South American guy. No, it's like, you know, working with some of the best people in the vein that we kind of all liked. I mean, rock, playing rock music. And it's not like we're not trying to be somebody that we aren't. We're not trying to be heavy metal. We're not trying to be, you know, all ballady or whatever. It's like
Describing us is even difficult. You know, listen to the records. That's pretty much us. You know,
I have a question from Joe McClure on Facebook. Who it's a bit of a music nerd question, which we like around here. He was like, "Can you please ask Tom what made him come up with the 12-string bass? As a bass player, he was my first bass love." So, Tom.
What made me come up with it? Just wanted the big sound, you know, something that sounded orchestrated and sounded like more than one person playing. So it's kind of like a grand piano, a guitar, a bass, and a kazoo all playing at the same time.
Because there's this theory floating around that it was like stringed instruments envy. It's like, you got five necks? Big deal. I got 12 strings. How do you like them apples, Rick?
Well, you know, we're basically a three-piece band, you know, guitar, bass, drums, and a lead singer. So it's like filling up that sound and filling up, you know, the parts. It was Tom started out as a guitar player, so it's like he could do what I'm doing, but you know, just people used to say, about the name Cheap Trick, they'd say, well, Cheap Trick, because you got other songs, other players somewhere, and you know, we knew how to fill up the sound with just really the guitar and bass, and by Tom having the 12-string bass, it's like nobody else can play it either. I mean, there's others who have played it, but nobody else can really play it like he does. And it made it kind of unique, because I mean, we're playing the same 12 notes everybody else does.
As you are getting ready to be inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, a lot of people would argue that the recording of Budokan is sort of what brought your genius to the attention of the world. And not too many people have a snapshot of their moment in time, like 2 hours that changed their lives. Do you have, and this again is a question from Janet on Facebook, do you have a fondest memory from the concert there as you look back on it, as you reflect getting ready to head into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame and drop the new record?
Holy cow, that's a mouthful there. let's see. In 1978, when we went to Japan for the first time, you know, we'd opened some big shows and we'd done some stuff, but we never really headlined that many things. And so we were, you know, we were the opening act for Kiss. We were the opening act for Queen. And so that was great stuff for us. And that was actually where we got some of the press and some of the notoriety with the Japanese people. So then we go there, and all of a sudden we're playing these huge places on our own and people knowing our music. I just thought, God, this is the greatest place on earth. You know, it's like,
wow.
You know, we left playing a bar in Iowa an hour before, and now here we are in Tokyo and 5,000 fans are chasing us around, and we're playing to sold out crowds. And our songs we had one of our songs, Clock Strikes 10, was a number one song in Japan. I mean, I don't think it got any airplay anywhere else in the world, but it was like, you know, it's like we had, by the time we were there, I think we had three hit singles, and it was like amazing. We had albums out and singles. It was like, you know, and back then in 78, how I relate to it a bit, it was before there was any sushi bars in the United States. You know?
Wow.
Nobody had sushi. That was brand new. And there was no Starbucks. It was, you know, it was a completely alien world.
Wow.
And there's no CNN either, right?
That was before that.
Not a lot of good viewing on TV there.
Definitely.
A lot of Japanese game shows.
I got a message from Adam who said, no question, but seeing you play Heaven Tonight at Riot Fest was his highlight of 2014. And it brings up an interesting point. Live, look, you've had hit singles, you've had hit albums, but it seems to me like the secret of Cheap Trick's long-term success is the connection you have with the people that come to see you play live.
Besides having regular people that just like music, we have a lot of musicians that come to see us. So that's, you know, And if you get a musician that comes to see another musician and they actually applaud or they say something good to you or they give you the finger or whatever it is, you know, it's like it's pretty amazing. And so we got a lot of that stuff, that for that show. I remember that Riot Fest that we played. They asked us to do, all right, you're Cheap Trick. You know, we're playing with all these bands, you know, newer groups and stuff. And they said, well, we'd like you to do your album Heaven tonight here. Okay. So, you know, we did it in its entirety from, you know, song one to the last song in order and, you know, then played other songs too. It was like, you know, for a lot of people that weren't even around when it came out, it was like, you know, these guys actually can play. And, oh, yeah, I've heard that. And it's like, God, it's so much, you know, it's powerful live. And it was a lot of different musicians who came around. I remember Andrew W.K. was at our show, and Patti Smith was there. And
Primus,
you know,
Reeves from The Cure was there.
Yeah, so yeah, there's a lot of people there, and they come to see us, and here we are. It's like, holy cow, you know, unless we're playing with somebody on tour, it's very rare that we get to see anybody, and you know, to have these guys come to see us, it was like pretty amazing.
Oh, I mean, it really speaks to the depth of your influence that you mean just as much to like an 18-year-old now as you did to their parents when they were 18 and beyond. And people like Billy Joe Armstrong of Green Day, Billy Corgan, The Pumpkins, Eddie Vedder, Pearl Jam, Kurt Cobain, Scott Weiland of Stone Temple Pilots, all these people.
Well, name somebody I've heard.
Point or
name somebody I've heard of.
All of them have said, if it wasn't for Cheap Trick, all of them have said, know them, pretty much.
Yeah, and that's pretty high honor.
Well, there's just a reason why your music connects with people, and you know, I think it's you as people, I think it's you as musicians, and I think this is why you are connecting with the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame next week and being inducted. It should have happened a little while ago.
Yeah, that's
we'll
right.
That.
You mean we
got
to?
Yeah, that's
gotta,
right.
We got to live up to all those accolades.
Oh my God, we better be good.
Oh my God.
Yeah. Robin, Rick, Tom, Dax, thank you so much for your time. Head out, get the amazing new record, Bang, Zoom, Crazy, Hello, and enjoy their induction into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. And as always, they will be coming to a town near you in the not-too-distant future, and it's going to be an amazing night that you don't want to miss. Cheap Trick, thank you so very much.
AD, AD, what's your real name?
It's short for Adrian.
Oh, okay. I thought it was short for BC.
That's what I was going to say.
Okay, never mind.
As an English guy growing up in America, I got stuck with it. People, Adrian, that doesn't really work. We have to shorten that to something that guarantees you never get chicks. So thank you guys very much for hanging out.
Thanks,
yeah. Could have called you Rick.
All right. Rick sounds like a guy that gets girls.
He does.
Not as much as Robin, but Rick does. Robin has, because, you know, you're Batman's sidekick. There's no two ways about it. There's a tremendous amount of appeal there.
I'll go with that. That sounds good to me.
I think
just
you're right.
So you know, FYI, this is going to be used as part of the interview.
Well, FUC.
You can edit it. ADBC, whatever.
Thanks.
Thank you.
AD.
Whatever. Guys, thank you so much. Have a great one.
Thanks a lot.
I never wanted just one kiss for sure.